Hey, how are we doing out there, guys? So welcome back to another episode of the Bastion Black Performance Podcast. So the thing I get requested the most is to talk about my personal experiences in the Second Battle of Fallujah, i.e. Operation Phantom Fury, as I was with 3rd Battalion, 1st Marines, which was the main effort during that particular operation. So I'm going to try to put that together here over the course of multiple episodes. I'm going to try to keep them somewhat, concise and coherent, but I'm also going to kind of use this almost as, I guess like a memoir for myself. So I'll kind of have something that has everything kind of recorded, because as I get older, I'm certain that I'll forget more things and become more intellectually useless. So this first episode, what I'm going to kind of discuss is sort of the preconditions to the battle, what my unit was doing, where we were at, some of the other goings on, and, kind of general things that were happening, and kind of use that to sort of set the scene or to set the conditions for talking about the battle itself. And it's one of those where I don't honestly know where to start, with talking about that, because it's like anything else when you talk about military stuff. It's like, hey, if you want to, you just talk about World War II, it's like, well, to understand World War II, you got to know this, and to understand that, you got to know this, and then you're like, shit, I'm all the way back in the year 1000 trying to figure out what's going on so I can understand World War II a little bit better. So what I'm going to do is basically just kind of give a rundown of, sort of like some basics of my, so this was my first deployment. So we got there into Iraq in the middle of June 2004. If I remember correctly, I believe we left from California on June 16th, 2004. And then I'll say this multiple times throughout the course of these videos, but I'm going to do the absolute best that I can to get dates correct, locations, names correct. I've managed to pull a couple of satellite images off of the internet of the city of Fallujah itself that are from 2004. And I actually recognize quite a bit of stuff there, and I think I'll be able to do a really good job of that. However, for the other things, I'll have to use, Google Earth, and I do not have the ability to look at, past Google Earth images. And obviously things are substantially different now, just as far as road construction, building construction, things like that. And I will try to, the dates part, I'm going to struggle with that an awful lot when it comes to the actual operations in Fallujah, because my status as a low-level grunt during that deployment meant that, I didn't have any, there's no phone or, internet, no phones, no computers, no nothing that we had access to at that time. I didn't have a calendar. I didn't have a, I wasn't recording anything, didn't have a journal, didn't have, anything like that. So honestly, this will sound kind of, a little bit like gallows humor, but the way that I can remember the dates the best is I just look up when certain people in my unit got killed, and then I know what day was what, and I can piece that stuff together fairly well. But a lot of it will also kind of run together. So, we'll kind of get started here a little bit. So my unit, so 3rd Battalion, 1st Marines, and I was in India Company, 3rd Platoon, 3rd Squad. So our first deployment, my first deployment rather, we were initially stationed in this area here, which is just east of Fallujah around the city of Karma, which as you can see is basically between Fallujah and Baghdad. Initially, we replaced 1st Battalion, 5th Marines. So 1st Battalion, 5th Marines were one of the They were one of the battalions that was involved in the First Battle of Fallujah, or the so-called Siege of Fallujah, in April of 2004. And so, kind of the way we're situated is my battalion's firm base was somewhere basically right about here. It's probably, I don't know, it might even be this down here. But basically, this major road that runs right here, this is what's called Route Michigan. So guys who've been to Iraq, Michigan, and this one that like bisects it right here is Mobile. So Route 1, that's Mobile. So this is called Michigan right here. So my battalion firm base, I know for a fact that we were south of Michigan, and there's this north-south running road with two big S-curves right here, which we called Route Chicago. And so I know exactly the route that we would take off of Chicago. We'd get on one kind of smaller road once we crossed Michigan, which is probably this road right here, and then we take it south. So battalion firm base was basically somewhere right around there. And then Camp Fallujah. So you guys have probably heard that. So Camp Fallujah was somewhere over and around here. I mean, it's probably this right here. You know, somewhere in and around that area. Like, it's hard to tell, 'cause I'll be honest. Like, there's, you know, some of the satellite images, it's not super obvious what things are. Actually, you know, if I had to guess, this is probably more like Camp Fallujah down here. See how much it actually zooms in on stuff. But anyways, you get the idea. So Camp Fallujah, roughly here, right here. My battalion's firm base there. So the way my battalion was situated, so we had one of our companies was over here. So Lima Company was in Nasser, Wasalem here, and then Abu Ghraib. So we called our battalion firm base Camp Abu Ghraib, not related to the prison itself. But the prison, the famous prison, is this right over there. I've never been over to that or anything. I never went to, I never went any further east than, you know, than basically our AO up in here. So, once we kind of got situated, so up in, you know, sort of, you know, the city itself here, which is, you know, mainly, you know, the population clustered around this area here. But as you can see, lots and lots of fields and stuff. And this up here, this dark line is a big canal called the Tiger's Arm. And so, it more or less connects the Euphrates to the Tigris via some other like sub canals up there by Habaniya. And so we operated, I honestly have no idea like where our east to west running, you know, like AO ended, because it just, again, I was a Lance Corporal, saw gunner, nothing on my first deployment. So that was kind of basically beyond my purview. But we basically, our northern limit was the Tiger's Arm. So, and then this highway right here, we called Route Lincoln, this major east to west running road there. And that's a full on hardball highway. These yellow lines pretty much are all full on hardball highway. So we operated primarily more or less between probably these roads over here and then over here. So we had a very massive AO, considering we also only had two companies up there, Lima and, or sorry, Kilo and India, because Lima was down in Nasser Wasalem for the most part. So we got there in June and took over for 1-5. We moved into a schoolhouse, which eventually got blown up, so I won't be able to find it on there. The schoolhouse was right off of Chicago and right along this tiny canal over there somewhere. So if I had to guess, there's a traffic circle, you know, in the middle of town somewhere. I don't know if I'd be able to find it now or not, because everything, like I said, everything looks completely different. It does not look the same. You know, so if I had to guess, it's this traffic circle right here, which means that this is where the school used to be, which was right there, and then it got blown up, and this is kind of a soccer field and stuff over there. But again, it does not look the same, because this little canal, that was right next to the school. So the school was basically here, so a little bit back from the road. I misspoke a little bit a second ago. So the school we were in was basically this area right here, and then it got blown up when we left. And so we'd come in off of Chicago, and this is, you know, I don't know if it's paved now, but this is basically just a little dirt road that we basically had a serpentine built up in, and then we were basically based out of right there. And then so we conducted our operations primarily out of there, but then we moved a little bit down here into what was called the Delta ING compound. We called it the Ding. And I don't know exactly how far down that goes. So it was down here by the water treatment plant. So it's probably, again, none of this is precisely the same. So it's kind of, you know, forgive me for appearing to be stupid. but the Ding is basically right in this area here. I mean, this might even more or less be it, but with a different parking lot structure there. So that was where we were. We conducted like typical operations and things like that, you know, like, you know, ton, like the basic way that we had it was we kind of had like a, you know, a setup that was basically, so we had four platoons, so first, second, and third platoon, and then weapons platoon. So at the time, weapons platoon was operating as just another regular rifle platoon. And so the way that we had it set up was we basically had like 2-day rotation. So for 2 days, you would be in the company firm base, so that the company's, you know, like FOB, and you would be manning the perimeter posts. And so while you were manning the post, obviously, you know, you're on a bunker here, or you're up on the roof on a machine gun there or whatever. Then when you were off post, you were doing working party stuff. So you had to burn the shit that's in the four hole shitters. You had to haul up sandbags and other equipment and do basic, you know, carpentry, you know, position repair, position building stuff there. And then if it was nighttime and you weren't on post, you might be able to get a few hours of sleep. Then you would do 2 days of QRF. So QRF is quick reaction force. So obviously, so you're basically the guys who are standing by. And if somebody, if one of your patrols gets, you know, in trouble and they have casualties, they'll call you, If they find like a big weapons cache or they take some prisoners or something and they just need, you know, additional bodies, they'll call you out. Or let's say they attacked, you know, they attacked the school because we got attacked quite a bit. And then, you know, but the patrolling unit was already out patrolling. Well, then they would send us out to respond to that or to go see what was going on, things like that. So while you're on QRF, you basically just had to stay in the, you know, kind of the, since we were in the school, so you're basically just kind of down in the big sort of common area, and you basically just had to hang out down there the whole time. And we always hated that because we weren't allowed to take our boots off for those 2 days, lest we be too slow to put them back on. So it was like you always had to spend like 2 days where you don't get any sleep and you just stand in one spot doing perimeter stuff, 2 days where you don't get to take your boots off at all. Then we would do 2 days where you were on operations. And so for ops, mostly what we'd do is we'd load up Humvees and then we'd be out in the vehicles for multiple days. So for 2 days, theoretically, and we basically wouldn't come back in that time. And so we'd stop somewhere, you know, two of the squads would dismount and go do patrols, do some IED sweeps over here, go sweep for weapons caches over here at night. Generally, so the squad that was, you know, so for us, our first squad were kind of the designated vehicle squads. Whenever we had vehicles, first squad were the guys that drove them and manned the machine guns in the back. And we absolutely hated first squad for that because every time we're out on operations, we'd set up like a little patrol base, you know, like a little perimeter for the platoon at night, kind of circle the vehicles, this or that. And then the first squad guys would get to go like, you know, 50% or 30%, i.e. So 50% means that basically you get a buddy, one of you is awake, you know, and either man in the position, man in the machine gun, or just, you know, observing while the other guy gets to sleep. Well, then the other two squads, so my squad, third squad, and then second squad, we'd always get sent out on ambush or night patrol. And so on ambush, I mean, it's basically like Vietnam kind of stuff. So you can see the terrain that we were in. They have a very good system of like canals that come off of this Tiger's Arm Canal. So you can see like most of the area we were in, very green, very lush. I mean, like lots of like literal rice paddies and, you know, other, you know, farmland and stuff like that. So we'd be out at night, like, you know, kind of humping through some of the bad bush and, you know, along these dirt roads and stuff, and then set up somewhere to do an ambush until morning. And then we'd either hump back or the vehicles would come and pick us up. And so then you wouldn't get any sleep. So you go 2 days where you basically get no sleep because you're standing on post, 2 days where you might get a little sleep, but you're not allowed to take any of your boots or clothes off. Then 2 days where you both don't get any sleep and don't get to take any of your boots off. And you basically walk for two straight days. And then we would go back to the battalion firm base for 2 days. And that was supposed to be where you'd get to go over to the, what do they call it? The MWR or whatever. So you get to go like make a phone call with your little calling cards that everyone had to buy before deployment. So you could call your family. We'd go out to the range. You know, we'd do training stuff. That's where they, you know, they'd kind of do other stuff like that. And if we were lucky, we might get to make a PX run over to Camp Fallujah, you know, kind of depending. And the good thing about going over there was like, you could basically buy like, you know, that was like when Red Bull came out at some point during my first deployment, or at least became available to us. That was when I heard about it. So it was like, you might get to make it to the PX and buy Red Bull and like bags of chips. Cause otherwise you didn't get to eat anything, like that. So that was how our rotation was supposed to work. It was very rare that it actually worked that way because we were so busy and we got attacked, you know, quite a bit, primarily IEDs and a lot of like indirect fire attacks on, you know, like our company's firm base there. And most of them were like, you know, ineffective or like stupid, but they basically we'd have to go walk around and, you know, like the big joke for us and probably the same for, you know, you other guys who have been over there. Like, you know, for us, the big joke was going to find the poo. We always had to go looking for the poo. And the poo means point of origin, i.e. where did they launch the mortar from, or where did they launch the 122 kinetic rocket from, or, you know, things like that. But so we're always out looking for poo. So we always thought that was kind of funny. Well, and we made up basically a sport that we were part of. We called it CCN, Canal Crossing and Negotiation, because where we were patrolling, so you kind of see like all these fields. You know, like basically every one of these fields, you know, there's like small ditches, small canals, you know, and other things basically between all of them and around all that stuff. So it was like, you either had to walk all the way around until there was some sort of crossing, or you had to like try to jump it / walk through it. And it was always really precarious, like wearing all of your gear, because for them, a perfectly acceptable crossing over these canals and like the farmland stuff would be that they would just fell a palm tree and just have it laying across there, or maybe a couple of palm trees, and they might drive vehicles across it. But it's like, you go walking across a palm tree when you're wearing like 100 pounds of gear in the middle of the summer, where beneath you is a canal of unspecified depth. And like, you don't, even if it's not a very far fall, like no part of you really likes that because you're like, well, shit, if I fall off of this, like I probably see a couple of bubbles and I just never come back up. So, so that was kind of, you know, that sort of set the, you know, kind of set the tone for what we did. So that was from June. And obviously the Battle of Fallujah started in November. So we're out there for, you know, a solid almost 5 months, you know, in the area. Now we did other things, you know, in conjunction with that, but that was kind of our basic, like our quote unquote, like day job, you know, doing those things. And, so in the middle of August, we occupied what we called TCP, so traffic control points. So if we see the city of Fallujah here, so this is the, like I said, this is the current Google Earth. So this looks different and has different roads on it than existed when I was there, but we can use this for a good general idea. So if we look to the southern part of Fallujah, there's this canal that runs, you know, somewhat parallel and then kind of skirts off of, this is the Euphrates River right here. So this area of the city down here, we occupied a traffic control point here. And then we had another one that was out closer to the river. It was somewhere out like over here, I think. It was probably, I think it was over in this area there. I didn't go to that one. That one was, that was TCP 7. And then we had TCP 8. So TCP 8 was literally this house right here. It's probably a different house, but I remember it specifically, and I'll tell the story why. Because there's a canal crossing just south of us. There was a big open field directly north of the building we're in, and then there were a couple houses. And so if you see this, so this is kind of an outcropping of the city itself. And this is significantly more populated with buildings and stuff than it was when we were there. When we were there, this was much more sparse before you kind of get into the city proper. So we occupied these traffic control points a couple of times. And so the main idea was, so during the first Battle of Fallujah in April, so spring of 2004, I'm not, you know, as up on the specific unit deployments of that time. So I'm going to speak a little bit general terms, but like 2nd Battalion, 1st Marines was kind of up in the Jolon area, the Northwest area here. The unit that we took over for 1-5, they were more in the South here. And for the most part, like 2-1 kind of just occupied holding positions. Cause obviously if you know, a quick look, this is all super residential, really tight, you know, quarters, lots of buildings, stuff like that. And this is what's known as like the industrial sector, which is the Southeast sector over there. So for the most part, like 2-1 and the units in the North kind of just sort of held position. They did like local patrols and stuff, but they kind of more or less like held their positions. But it was the units in the South that kind of actually sort of moved into the city. And it's kind of a whole clusterfuck with, you know, everything they were doing there. So the reason for these traffic control points, or as I've talked about in my other videos, you want to set the conditions for an assault. So what they wanted to do is, one, at this time, the city of Fallujah had the quote-unquote Fallujah Brigade, which was a brigade of like Sunni Iraqis who after you know, they kind of reached, you know, peace negotiations and they pulled Americans out of Fallujah, then they put the Fallujah Brigade in charge of it to control things. And obviously they were like, every single one of them were, you know, corrupt to a man, every single one of them. So basically, so the pullout came basically in May. And so basically between May and November, there were not coalition forces in the city. I mean, I'm assuming there were, you know, reconnaissance elements and, you know, like small teams of, you know, probably like, you know, Delta dudes and CIA guys and stuff like that. But there were no, like, there was no like actual like American presence in the city. So they had all the time in the world to set up defensive positions, rig IEDs and all sorts of things like that we can kind of talk about as we get to later. So what they wanted to do with these traffic control points was they wanted to draw the attention to the southern part of the city. They wanted the enemy to basically set up their defenses, dig their positions, and basically plan for an assault that was going to come from the southern part of the city again, because it came from the southern part of the city as far as the elements that were actually advancing before. And then obviously in the actual Battle of Fallujah, we attacked from the north. So now, I don't know the specific reasoning for that. You know, it's obviously like, you know, things I'm not, you know, I wasn't privy to at the time, and I haven't actually seen anyone's paper that said, hey, this is the exact reason we want to do this. My guess is that if I had to try to look at this and figure out why they would do that, is the north part of the city is pretty much all residential, and it's much more modern residential. So you have bigger houses. Obviously, they're very tightly clustered like all of them are, but much more modern residential. So my guess is they wanted to try to get as much of the focus and as much of the personnel further south in the city. So by the time we attacked them in the north, they would not be able to move back north really easily without getting interdicted by, you know, our superior air power and supporting arms and stuff like that, so that they could relatively lower the amount of damage that they caused, like collateral damage, to the major residential areas, and try to keep them primarily in the poorer, lower quality housing areas, you know, lower quality like residential neighborhoods, and the industrial areas where they'd be kind of easier to deal with. That would be my guess, but I don't know that specifically. So we occupy these traffic control points down here. And so we took over for a Kilo Company platoon that was down here. So they went out and set it up. So like I said, we're basically in this building here. So they went out and set it up, and they're out there for 4 days. And then they send my platoon out there to relieve them. And so, and I remember every single second about going to TCP-8. Because we had just come off ops. My platoon was on ops. And I remember we had done an ambush, and like we had done patrol like all day long. We patrolled like every second of the day before. And then at night we holed up in like a position out in the middle of this field. And I remember I was so tired, and I was paired up with my buddy Solberg out in the field. And you know, in your head you go, hey, you know, I'll stay awake the first hour, you go to sleep, and then we'll switch. But you can never like make it an hour. Like you're falling asleep, like, you know, instantly. So we kind of cut it down. Hey, let's do 30 and 30. And then it was like, hey, man, I can't stay awake for 30. Can we do like 15 and 15? So then it basically kind of becomes like one of you is like up and observing, and the other one isn't really sleeping, but he kind of gets to roll over on his back and sort of relax for a few minutes, and then you switch. And so then it gets to be light out. And then as soon as it's light out, that's when, you know, we as like, you know, low-level guys, they're like, hey, we're going to go take over in this, you know, traffic control point. You know, and we were really excited because they're like, hey, we're going to go over like by Fallujah. And we're like, yay, you know, because we, just, you know, we want to go over there so we can get in a fight instead of all this stupid IED chasing and indirect fire. And very rarely, like, you know, up till that point, I don't think I'd fired a round at anybody. So we come out, relieve Kilo Company. And so in addition to my platoon, we also had a sniper team out there. So for us, sniper's call sign was Alpha Male. So we had like four alpha males, which is kind of funny. But so we had an alpha male team out there. We had the company 60 millimeter mortar. So guys who have seen my other videos talking about organization of companies and battalions. So the 60 millimeter mortar is the company level indirect fire asset. We also had the battalion's 81 millimeter mortar. So the 81 millimeter mortars, which is substantially bigger, substantially longer range, that is a battalion level asset. So we had the 60 mortars, the 81 mortars out there. Sniper team, and then we had a CAT section. So now they usually call them MAPS, Mobile Assault Platoons. At the time, we had kind of the original conventional war designation, so CAT team, so C-A-A-T, Combined Anti-Armor Team. So weapons company, which is an infantry company, you know, heavy weapons company, they basically, so what they would have is like, so a CAT team would have like four Humvees, and then usually, and so you kind of have a combination, but basically there'd be like, there might be one or two 50 cals, a tow launcher, maybe two tow launchers, and then either another 50 cal or a Mark 19. But you'd have four Humvees, you know, you'd have a 50 cal, you'd have a tow launcher, and you'd have probably a Mark 19 somewhere in that, and you'd probably have two of one of those. And so their main job was, they roamed around, you know, and so like I kind of flashed out to this before. So they roamed around on like Mobile and Michigan over towards RAO, and then they set up what we call SNAP VCP, SNAP Vehicle Control Points. And they would do like vehicle searches and basically kind of doing like what cops do with DUI checkpoints. Don't get me started on the morality of those. But so basically do that kind of stuff to sort of interdict the movement of weapons and, you know, fighters and things like that. So we have all these assets out there. So we have one platoon, we have a CAT team, we have a sniper team, battalion 81s, and company 60s within this perimeter. And so within this perimeter, so like I said, there's the actual building here is where we were like staying, but there's a couple like smaller houses or whatever over here. And so we were kind of basically just in this sort of cluster there. Now, in addition to that, we also had a platoon of tanks that were out with us. And so basically what we're doing at this traffic control point is we had a bunker that was basically, so we had one bunker that was set up right here on the road, and we had another bunker that was basically set up right here on the road. So at the time, basically what would happen is all the vehicles that were leaving would get stopped and would get searched, and then they'd be allowed to go through, and all the vehicles coming in would get stopped and would get searched. And that was one of the main things. So it's a little bit deceiving right now, but this road right here did not exist at the time. This road right there did not exist at all. So you either came in on this road, which was a somewhat like actual paved, like decent road, or you had to take one of these smaller sub roads or come in up on, you know, the main, like main Michigan road up there. So that was basically how they were interdicting that. And then what they would do is during the day, the tanks would basically go off like over here, and they would kind of occupy positions like sort of along here. And they would just basically scan with their optics and like shoot at people. Because at this time, like in Fallujah, like dudes are just, they were walking around carrying AKs and RPGs and stuff like that. And then the sniper team was set up, you know, in this building that was basically right across from us, or they might go out somewhere else. And they're basically just calling in indirect fire. So they're basically just calling in our mortars like all day, like interdicting stuff. And their BDA for like the, we ended up being out there for 8 days. Their BDA for that time was like 500. It was just, it was ridiculous. And, so then at night, what would happen is the tanks would come back and they'd basically set up a tank on the road facing this direction, a tank on the road facing that direction, and then we would close down, you know, the bunker at night. So we'd have like, you know, had posts up on the roof of the building. We had, there were additional posts that were out here, you know, kind of in, you know, basically like this little, like, you know, sort of farm fields or whatever out there. So we'd man those and stuff like that. And we had a machine gun under the, like the second floor overhang of the building, but then tanks would actually go out and physically block the road, and it would be closed off at night so nobody could come in and nobody could go out. So we're basically out there, and during the day it was kind of, you know, so we get out there on the it had to have been the 14th, so we get out there on August 14th 2004, and I remember, like I said, I can remember all of this really well because like I said a minute ago, we just come off from like patrolling absolutely every second of the day, got no sleep at night. They drive us straight out there. We get there, relieve them. We have to start building these posts, you know, because it was still fairly undeveloped as far as defensive positions go. So we're spent all day filling sandbags, digging positions and stuff like that. And then I have to pull first shift on a Mark 19. And so the way it was set is, like I said, this isn't exactly what it looked like at the time, but basically, you know, building was more like over here. And so the second floor, so the roof / second floor hung out further than like the actual, you know, vertical walls of the building. So we were dug into the ground under that. So actually, I mean, really good defensive position. And we had a Mark 19 there. And I was sitting there by myself at night, which was just, I mean, it's the most tired I've ever been in my whole life. And at one point, my squad leader, Corporal Kruger, came up and I was having a conversation with him. You know, and I kept, you know, I stood up and was kind of like walking around, like, you know, I mean, I'm sitting in a, like a hole, but I'm basically kind of just like, you know, pacing, like a step here, step there, trying to stay awake. And he comes up and kind of yells at me. He's like, "Hey, what are you doing?" I was like, "Corporal, like I'm falling asleep. Like I'm at the end of my rope here." And, so I'm having a conversation and then, you know, he kind of goes away. And then, you know, our corpsman, Doc McAfee, comes up. So inside of the house, there was a window right there that basically was just a couple feet away from the position. So Doc McAfee comes up to the window and, you know, and I'm having a long conversation with him, and my squad leader walks back around. He's like, "Who are you talking to?" I was like, "Oh, I was talking, you know, talking to Doc Mac." And he goes, "Doc Mac is on the other side of the building." I just walked past him and he's snoring in his sleep. So I hallucinated an entire conversation with Doc McAfee because I was exhausted. And so, you know, I managed to make it through the night. I get a chance to go in and, you know, get a little bit of sleep. And then it's morning and I'm inside and all of a sudden, like I'm standing inside and there was no power, no nothing. So like, and there was a dirt floor inside the building. So it's kind of just grimy conditions. So inside and then all of a sudden, boom, humongous explosion. And the one that was like, it was a shocking explosion because they've been launching 81 and 60 millimeter mortars, you know, basically nonstop through the night, during the day. And 81 millimeter mortars are very loud. Like 60 mortars are incredibly loud. Like the 60 mortar is the most, it's the loudest of all the organic, you know, company level infantry weapons. So that like mortars are very loud and all of a sudden, boom. And like the whole house, the whole ground shakes or whatever. Go outside and, you know, so like running out. And basically, you know, someone comes in at some point, you know, and we're like, "Hey, like what happened?" And we have no idea. And so they like, you know, somebody comes in, I don't remember who it was specifically, kind of grabbing some of us up. You're like, "You know, Grease, come with us, you know, like get in here, whatever." So they kind of get me in one of the vehicles and, you know, like an open backed Humvee. And they take us out to take us out to the road. So they take us out to this road right here. And as we get out there, there's definitely like dudes laying down on the road, like casualties. And so we get out there and they're like, hey, you know, someone yells out, you know, like, you guys, like, you're taking them Kazovac, you know, back to Bravo Surgical. And so Bravo Surgical was at Camp Fallujah over here. And so we're way over here. And so we load up these two guys. I mean, it's been 20 years by now, so I can say their names, I suppose. So Perez and Hannon. And so we load them up, and we're also, we start taking indirect fire. So as I'm in the back of a, you know, we just call them troop carrier Humvee. So it's one that has kind of, you know, has like armored sidewalls, but it's completely open in the top. And we start taking indirect fire right next to the road. And it's kind of splashing stuff up against the armor. I don't know if it's rocks or if it's shrapnel, whatever. You know, so boom, boom, boom. Some of that's hitting on the road, and we take off. And we bolt back to Camp Fallujah. And I think we had a medevac Humvee with us. And then we had a couple of additional Humvees. There wasn't very many of us. I want to say three or four vehicles was what we had total that went back there. And this was our first time anywhere out in this area, because this was not our AO as a battalion. Like, this was somebody else's AO. So we're not familiar with this area at all. And so we had literally just come out here. So we basically come out, and it was basically this gravel road that takes us back to Mobile. And then you take Mobile up to like this road right here. And again, we'd only gone there one time. So we get back to the surgical center, and anybody who's like deployed in a similar area like this will probably sound somewhat familiar. So we come into, so going on to, at the time we called it the MEC. It later got changed to Camp Fallujah. So we called it the MEC, M-E-K. I think, you know, the army guys who, you know, initially set it up, that's what they call it for whatever reason. So as we're coming through there, so like you have to like check in at the gate. So, I mean, we're like obviously Americans and Humvees and, you know, vests and helmets and all that stuff. But you have to like check in at the gate. What's your name? What's your unit? Blah, blah, blah. So we kind of just blow past that dude. And then like when you come through the gate, like it's a little bit of a drive, like within the camp itself to like get over there. I mean, I don't really want to estimate a distance, like, you know, probably a mile or 2 miles in like total driven distance, maybe slightly further. But like you're not just like in the camp and hey, the surgical unit's like right over there. Like you kind of have to get in there. And so as we're like driving through, there's like people that are in the way because it's like chow time. And most of the people that worked there were just super freaking pogues. You know, guys who didn't face like a lick of danger their entire deployments and lived better there than we did on Camp Pendleton back in California. So we're like having to scream at people to get out of the way. One of the guys beamed a dude with a liter and a half bottle of water, you know, because he had the audacity to like yell at the Humvee like he was some pedestrian, you know, in a metro area in America or whatever. And, you know, like, he's like, hey, watch where you're going. So bonk, beans him with a water bottle to get out of the way. So, and it just so happens the surgical unit is cattywampus, i.e. catty corner behind the chow hall. So we have to go around that. And we get back over there. And so as we're going to unload them, I don't know the condition of the casualties, and they're in a different vehicle. So as we get there, like everyone rushes over to, you know, this is kind of like at least my experience with casualties. So everyone rushes over. And so at the time, Hannon was still alive. And so basically everybody rushes over to try to grab a hold of his stretcher. So they like, you know, however many there, you know, of us, there were 10, something like that, you know, whatever, a dozen. Everybody rushes over, try to grab that. And the other Marine, Perez was dead. And, so nobody would go over there and grab him. So I actually went over and grabbed Perez with one of the mortuary affairs guys, and we carried him into the actual morgue. So then we basically get Hannon unloaded, and we get back in, and we have to go back. So we rush back. And so as we get back, we come off of this gravel road here, and we're coming up, and as we turn here, it is like a scene out of freaking Apocalypse Now. There's like black smoke billowing, vehicles on fire all along like this area here. And we're like, dude, what the fuck happened? So we get back, and like right as we get back, like I kind of hop out of the vehicle, like basically, you know, like right along here along the road, my platoon sergeant's there. And so he snags me up, and he's like, Grease, get over here. All right, yes, Staff Sergeant. He's like, you're gonna go with Lopez and Thompson, and I want you guys to sweep the area, make sure it's clear. And I'm like, oh, okay. So basically, so we set it up. So there was, you know, obviously, you know, and I found out the details obviously like after this, but so all I know is there's dead bodies like on the, like kind of on the road and a couple in the field, and there's like multiple vehicles like on fire. And like I just hopped out as early as I could, run over there, because I want to get in some action. And so he basically snags me up. So I'm carrying a saw at the time. And so basically the way we set it up is Corporal Lopez walked on the road. Thompson, Lance Corporal Thompson, walked on what for us was the left side of the road, but was the east side. And then I walked on the right side of the road, which was this side. And the road is a little bit raised up. So obviously it doesn't sit like specifically level with the ground. So we go to walk through there and, you know, basically to like, you know, sweep it to make sure that, you know, the dead people are actually dead and, you know, anybody who's hiding and things like that. And, so as we're walking through, there's a vehicle that's on fire right in front of me, and it is just billowing black smoke. So I'm walking through there. And so I kind of got my saw sort of like chicken winged or kind of like half shouldered, and it's a little creepy. Like I kind of feel like I'm in a, you know, like a World War II movie at the time, you know, cause there's just like billowing black smoke. I can't see anything directly in front of me cause it's covered my vision. And I know the dudes, you know, so I know that Lopez should be directly to my left. And then the other side, you know, of the road is Thompson. And all of a sudden I hear like crack, crack, crack. And so I hear rounds going off, and now I don't know if it's coming in or going out cause I can't see through the smoke. So I'm kind of just like, you know, kind of just like creeping, you know, through here. And all of a sudden, like, as I come through there, there's a guy, you know, kind of like on the ground who sees me, looks, and then tries to take off. And so I was like, brat, and hit him with 3-round burst with the saw from probably, I don't know, 10 yards away, and dumped him on the ground right there. And my saw was such a piece of shit. So it jammed, as it always did, because guys have used the saw. So you know how you have the buttstock retaining pin. You know, because with the saw, you take the retaining pin out and you can actually rotate the stock down. So you could, you know, we never really did that, but you could set that basically on the ground and then remove the guts of the gun to clean it without having to like turn the whole gun over and set it down on there. Well, we never had enough retaining pins or the other little like cotter pins inside that hold them in place. So like mine was zip tied together, which was a pretty common thing for us. And so that sucker never worked. And it wasn't very well lubed because 2004 was still a time when like, nobody actually knew the correct answers for like how to lube a weapon in sandy conditions, where now we know that your gun will function better if it's really dirty and lubed than if it's not as dirty, but also not lubed. But at that time, you know, there was still always like, hey, lube it, but not very much. You don't want to get too dirty. And like saws got to be lubed to work very well, especially our old, you know, POSs from the 1980s. So anyways, it's unsurprising that the saw jammed because it did that to me all the time. And, so I was like, brat, 3 rounds. And I hit, so I only hit the guy with 2 of them cause it kind of, you know, the gun kind of rose out of my, you know, as I shot it. So one of them hit him right in the spine. And, it was kind of weird. Cause I've shot a lot of deer and stuff like that. And, but this is my first person that I shot. And, so it's kind of funky cause the guy kind of was like against the embankment there. And it was like, it went into like a massive spasm. And so like, it basically like, so his hips like drove into the embankment, but like his upper body came off and it was kind of like he was like up and waving, but like his chest and upper body were like off the ground. And the second round, so basically what it was is I fired the burst and I was kind of aiming like high. One round hit him in the spine. One round basically went right past his head. And then the other round hit his hand that was kind of out in front of his head, hit his wrist and basically just exploded his wrist. He was a big old fat dude, and he was wearing a purple sweatsuit in the middle of like in August in Iraq. So I don't know, whatever. But then there's like all this fat running out of his arm. So that was super, super like weird, you know, kind of hits and comes up. And so then, you know, now I'm kind of through the smoke and I look and Lopez is over there. And I was like, hey, dude, I just freaking shot that dude. And he goes, I've been shooting at him. Like that one counts as mine, you know? And I was like, what? Like he was like 100% still alive when I got over here. So we had an argument about like credit, which is pretty normal for military guys. So we kind of keep pushing down. And so there's a, so this guy down there on the road and, you know, there's like a couple of them and one of them is like, he looks like he's like, you know, somebody sees him like, you know, hey, like this one's still alive. This one's still alive. And I was basically, you know, and as you know, the lieutenant was kind of coming up behind Lopez on the road at this time. And he's like, hey, that guy up there is like still alive. So I was like, shoot him. And he's like, no, hesitation kills, or in this case, hesitation did not kill. And so I was like, sir, step back. I'll hit him. And it was like in the way. And so then the lieutenant's like, oh, we're going to take him prisoner. But he's kind of hiding like half under one of their vehicles that were on the road, you know, that they tried to attack us with. And there is no good reason for not shooting this person, because the risk that they have a grenade or an IED is entirely too much to really take this sort of risk, especially when the area itself is not cleared out of there. Like this violates no rules of engagement in any capacity whatsoever. Like you do not have to take an additional risk for what is an armed combatant, especially with the risk of, you know, suicide related attacks like that. So he's like, no, we're going to take him prisoner. No, we're going to take him prisoner. And he's in my way. So I couldn't take the shot, cause I definitely would have, cause that was that would be the correct decision there. So he kind of backs up, and again, like the whole, like the area is not like completely secure, but now we're basically all like forced to be drawn into this stupidity. And so the lieutenant starts trying to give him commands. And he's basically like, if you can see me, like I'm in my reloading room, like I'm making motions right now. But so the guy's like kind of laying on his stomach, and then he's moving, and he's trying to tell him to push himself up with his hands and then sweep under him with one of his hands to like show us there's no grenade under there or anything like that. And so he's making these motions, and he's like, push yourself up, you know, sweep yourself or whatever. And it's like, he's getting nowhere at all. So I go through a couple iterations of this, and finally my platoon sergeant, he just walked like straight, like strolls past the lieutenant and just grabs this guy by the hair and just drags him out from the vehicle. You know, doesn't know if he's got a vest on, doesn't know if he's got a grenade on him or whatever, but he was just so frustrated with the lieutenant, you know, being like completely stupid about all this stuff. He just said, fuck it, goes up, grabs him, drags him out of there. And so we got that guy, and the guy's pretty, like he's wounded, like he's pretty messed up. And so by now I'm kind of down basically by the bunker that was on the road down here, if you see my cursor still. And so I asked my platoon sergeant, so like looking out over here, there's kind of like, you know, there's like reeds, or not reeds is the wrong word. There's like, you know, brush and stuff like that out over there. And so, you know, I'm a 19-year-old Lance Corporal at the time. So I'm asking permission for things that I should have just, you know, if I go back and do it again now, I just start shooting and not ask. But I said, you know, Staff Sergeant Mac, can I put a whole drum, you know, can I work that brush across with the whole drum, see if there's anyone laying out in that still? He's like, no. And I was like, I think we should. And he said, no. Okay, so I didn't. Well, we ended up finding a guy out there like later that night or whatever who was hiding. And Lance Corporal Grease was right about that. But so it turns out what had happened was we had the bunkers here where they would search vehicles, and like a serpentine in front of each of them. So one for the north moving side here, and one for the south moving side going in and going out of the city. So apparently what it was is, so the guys at the bunker down there, so during the day they have to search. So there's three guys down there, Kelly, Perez, and Hannon. And like, so one guy would stay in the bunker and two guys would basically go out to like command the vehicle and to search it and stuff like that. So apparently this car, you know, kind of comes to the serpentine. They wave it up to come talk to him, and the guy kind of waved at him. So they said, hey, you know, come up here. So then basically, you know, as they waved it to come closer, like apparently Perez was like looking in the vehicle, and the guy, boom, detonates it. And so he was killed outright. And then Hannon ended up dying later on. They were able to stabilize him for some amount of time, tried to fly him out of there, and then he did eventually die from that. So at this point, we closed down the TCP. We closed down the traffic control point. Nobody comes in, nobody goes out through it whatsoever. And so we kind of go through the night, and then the next morning I'm in this bunker that faces to the south. So what would be guarding the route coming into the city, or coming into our traffic control point. And by now we have signs and like barbed wire kind of way out in front of us, you know, kind of like, you know, hey, you're not allowed to come past here, anything like that. And then we still have the serpentine is out in front of there. And so I'm in this bunker with a guy by the name of Philip West, Lance Corporal West. And so the bunker has a 240 in it. And so one of us would be on the 240, one of us had a rifle. So as we're sitting there, this vehicle comes up the road. And it was a little weird because we you didn't really see any traffic there. So as he's coming up the road, the signs that said, hey, turn around, were actually in front of this road. If you see my cursor, we're in front of this road that goes across the canal. So technically speaking, somebody could have come past the first sign, still turned to go across the canal, and been within what they were allowed to do. But so as we're sitting there, the guy was driving very slow. So he kind of comes up past the first barrier. And I'm like, hey, West, this dude's coming. And he's like, oh, he'll turn off on that canal road. He's like, oh, okay. So he keeps kind of driving like real slow. And then, there's like additional signs and stuff like after, like once you get past, like right up to the road, like basically there's a sign and there's some concertina wire. The concertina wire doesn't go like completely across the road to completely block it. The reason being is that like we didn't want it like something that we would have to like run out there to remove to get us like in or out, because we already had serpentine barriers that controlled the road physically. So we didn't feel like we needed the concertina wire all across that. So he kind of comes like past the road, past the wire. And so I remember I looked at Wes and I'm like, I go, dude, this guy's still driving. So I pull back on the charging handle on the 240 to load it. And then the guy comes up to like basically like, my trigger line that I'm allowed to shoot at, drives past that, boom, cut into him with the 240. And he was driving one of those little like Toyota Hilux or, like little Datsun pickups or whatever it was. And it had a couple like oil drums in the back. So, obviously I'm thinking car bomb again. So I unload an entire can, so 200 rounds into the truck. And what was funny was they put one of those like machine gun optics. I'm trying to think of what the actual optic is. It's the ones we got from the Canadians, but it's got like multiple stadia in it. It's like the big black cylindrical one. But apparently they put it on there and didn't zero it. Don't get me started on stupid things that command structures do during deployments, but they basically put it on there and didn't zero it. So the guy was about, 200 yards away, where the actual trigger line was. So I put the 200 stadia like right on the windshield and just cut loose a long burst. And every single round in that burst hit way low and into the HESCO barriers that were like of the serpentine out in front of us. So I kind of just made a guesstimation, cranked up, put a different stadia on there, cut loose a big burst, and just knifed straight into that vehicle. And it caught on fire, was all sorts of messed up and everything. And then so I unloaded 200 rounds. So then I dropped it, picked up another can, loaded it, and then I put a few more bursts in it. Because again, I'm thinking car bomb. So I was basically trying to shoot it until something exploded. And so kind of I get through about 35 more rounds out of that build. And nothing happens, and it's like billowing fire. It is like on freaking fire. And I was like, oh, well, okay, I think we got it. And so West has the balls standing in a bunker with me where I am the only one who is facing out of the actual like embrasure that faces down the road, because there was another embrasure / window that faced. So my opening faces directly onto the road. His faced this way towards the canal, but he kind of like contorted his body and leaned out of there and shot three rounds with his rifle. And he had the balls to go, man, I can't believe I shot that guy. And I looked at him and I go, I can't believe you did either, because you didn't shoot the guy. Like the guy with the machine gun, which is me, shot the guy. And so he maintained that this vehicle that was 200 yards away, windshield and all, that he leans out of this window, fires three rounds, and he's the one who stopped it. So I guess someday I may get to ask a higher power whether or not that's true. And I cannot wait to rub it in West's face. I'm definitely the guy who shot that guy. So that ends that argument right there. But anyway, so the vehicle's still on fire, but there's no explosion or anything like that. So it kind of moved one of the cat vehicles with the 50 cal. They kind of moved it over here a little bit so we could have a little bit of an angle on there, and had him fire a few like rounds at it. And, nothing went off. So then they had, who was actually my fire team leader, Lance Corporal Thompson. They had him come out over here, like down in the, because like I said, the field, the road sits above the field, like a couple of feet. So they had him come down here with an AT-4, to try to shoot the vehicle with AT-4 and set it off. And for some reason, He aimed at the windshield, which wasn't intact by this time, shot the AT-4 straight through the windshield out the back, and it blew up somewhere over here in the field. But so it turned out it was just oil drums and wasn't a bomb. And I got up there and searched the guy. And so the guy had like a 38 snub-nose revolver, a rifle. He had a 38 snub-nose revolver and a knife and nothing else. So we don't know what the deal was. Like, can the dude not read? Was he basically trying to get somebody to come out to the vehicle so he could try to shoot at him with the pistol? I don't know. Like, you know, basically we were following the rules of engagement. Guy drove past multiple signs, multiple pieces of barbed wire, all the cones, and then towards the bunker. So shot him, did what we had to do there. So, you know, we kind of stay out here for an additional, so we're out here, like I said, for basically 8 days. So we kind of get to the end of our 4 days out here. And, we literally, oh man, this, I can still taste the sting of this, almost 20 years later. But so we finally get the command to break this thing down at the end of like our 4 days. And so like guys who've been in the military know, it's like you break down a position, like you got to cut open all your sandbags, just, you know, burn your sandbags, like destroy all your positions, whatever. So we do all of that. We load up in the vehicles or whatever. We're kind of sitting, waiting, you know, like, hey, why aren't we leaving perimeter? Comes over the radio. Hey, disregard. We want you guys to stay there an additional 4 days. So we had to go and rebuild and refill every single sandbag, every single position. So it was just like, that one I can still feel in my bones to this day. But so while we're out there, and these events, I don't know which one of these happened first or you know, which one came later. So there's a couple of funny events that kind of happened. So like I said, we had snipers, we had tanks out there with us and stuff like that. So they're also flying a drone around, and drones were like really new at the time. So, for us, the other thing about this part of like what made it nice is because we would be taking indirect fire basically all day when we were occupying the traffic control point. But as you kind of see where the main part of the city is and then where the outcropping of buildings are, it's kind of like a funnel. So this kind of like this area sort of shielded us from pretty much all their indirect fire attempts because they could just never get the range very, very well adjusted because all these buildings were in front of them. So they were firing at us a lot. They were firing like machine guns and stuff at us at night because we'd trade a lot of tracers back and forth. They never really caused us any, you know, anguish with that. But so they're flying a drone up somewhere over the city here. And by the grace of Allah himself, they managed to shoot this drone down. And what the old bad guys didn't know is that while they shot the drone down, it wasn't destroyed. So it's still kicking back like camera and GPS related information. So apparently they run out to basically pick this drone up. And so they're looking at it, examining it. And again, as the story goes, I didn't personally see this, but as the story goes, they basically have these guys' faces like on camera as they're looking at this, and it's feeding back, you know, coordinates. So they basically call in 60 millimeter mortar mission from within our position there and just fried a whole boatload of Terry's with that. So that was kind of a funny story. And then there's another story that I tell. We call this guy Big Balls Bob. So, like I said, tanks would come out and occupy positions kind of like out here. So they had like the combat earth movers with them. So basically like the bulldozer tanks and stuff, kind of built them little berms to hide behind, and they'd sit out there. And so apparently, you know, old Bob, he didn't know there were multiple tanks, or he wasn't exactly sure where they were at. So he's got an RPG on his shoulder, and he comes walking around this wall, just strolling like he's just, you know, out and about in town. And basically looking for a tank. And meanwhile, like the tank's just following him with the gun. Like, what is this guy doing? And so basically he keeps walking around this wall. He must have been expecting them to be on a different side of it or something. He has no idea that the tank is directly at his 9 o'clock and like, you know, less than 100 yards away. But at some point he becomes aware of it. And so he just stops and freezes in place. And he kind of slowly takes one knee. And he slowly adjusts the RPG down onto his shoulder. And he slowly rotates himself to his left, to his left, to his left, to his left. Boom. Tank hits him with main gun round. So they call that guy Big Balls Bob because rather than just, you know, dropping his RPG and running off, and he probably would have been able to get away, you know, and one, RPG 7 wasn't going to do anything to that Abrams anyways. So that was a funny story from that. And then there was another funny story that came from there. And this one's completely secondhand information, so I I didn't get to see any of this, but apparently, the tanks had kind of gone out in these same positions, like, a few times. So it wasn't a secret where they were at. And so apparently one of these times there was a guy in a suicide vest who decided he was going to run up onto one of the tanks and detonate a suicide vest. And that's how he's going to take out the tank. But one, he didn't have a big enough vest, and he hadn't fully accounted for the fact that, like, explosives tend to go up and out path of least resistance. So he runs out. I'm assuming he did some level of Allah Akbar, jumps on the tank, boop, sets that thing off. And all that happened was it blew a big bloody streak up the tank. So the tank comes back into perimeter, and we're like, did you guys hit a deer? Like, what happened out there? And they're like, oh, well, guy jumped on us with a suicide vest, and, Mac down there almost spilled his drink, something like that. So that was kind of a funny story from that. And I'll tell one more story from TCP-8 before we kind of, sort of move on and, kind of get ourselves like closed off for the first episode of this for the day. So we had intel, and again, by we, I mean the unit. I wasn't privy to any of this. These are things I had to find. I had to piece all these things together later on. But so they had intel that apparently there was a big meeting of insurgents and stuff, like at a mosque somewhere in the city here. So, and we, like I said, we've been launching like mortars nonstop all day, all night from the 81s and the 60s this whole time. And so they get word that there's this big meeting. So the company commander, Captain Clark, we called him Captain Swayze because he looks like a slightly more jacked but shorter version of Patrick Swayze. And so he calls in, Cannonball. So Cannonball was the call sign for 81 mortars. And so they're cooking us up, and you can hear him come over the radio, Cannonball, this is Raider. And so regimental command themselves breaks in over the radio. And regimental command was Blue Diamond, because if you guys see the 1st Marine Division, emblem, like our is a blue diamond with a red one down the middle, and says Guadalcanal on it. And so Blue Diamond breaks in over the radio, like, disregard, you are not cleared for 81s without permission from Blue Diamond. So basically what he's telling the company commander is you are not allowed to use the battalion level assets without contacting the regimental combat team for permission. And so without missing a beat, Captain Clark, so it was call sign Raider. So he goes, copy that, Blue Diamond, break, long shot, your mission. And long shot is company 60 millimeter mortars. So basically the regimental commander told him, you are not allowed to use the 81 millimeter mortars without my express permission. And he goes, okay, no problem. 60 millimeter mortars, your job. So that's basically just a big middle finger right to you. So boom. So 60 millimeter mortars do the job, take the mission. And, we kind of watched that, and they actually skipped one of their rounds off of the minaret on the mosque. So sure enough, like an hour later or something like that, Blue Diamond himself comes through the, perimeter, comes through, this south, bunker, and almost relieved, Captain Clark, like, on the spot, but did not. And then they left the position. So that was kind of interesting. So kind of bring it back a little bit to we're talking about, like, grander scheme here. So like I said, so we occupied these traffic control points, down here in 7 and 8, to basically draw focus and to attrit the enemy. So because we're down here, the enemy was still trying to attack us, bringing themselves out. So then we were calling in indirect fire. We had snipers. We had tanks out there. They tried to launch. I guess I didn't explain that. So apparently, what their attack was after the the vehicle, the vehicle-borne IED, the VBED, was they had, I forget, it was either 3 vehicles or 5 vehicles. So it was either 3 vehicles and 5 dudes, or 5 vehicles and 7 dudes. I don't honestly remember. But they basically came across the canal road, right there. And basically just tried to speed and run through the perimeter and then get out and start shooting stuff and throwing grenades. But they hadn't accounted for the fact that one is just a stupid idea. But like when you come through here, the Serpentine is much further away from the building where most of the people are than you could throw a grenade. And so, and by then we're on high alert. So they had most of the guys arrayed out on the roof and another position. So as soon as they came through, basically, an entire platoon worth of dudes just laid into him and chopped him up pretty good. So that was not a good plan on their part. The early days of the GWAT and the people without the good guerrilla related experience on that. So like I said, so that was the main idea, you know, as far as drawing attention down there. So now this was in August, like I said, August 14th was when we went out there. So we were still out in this area until the end of October. So we were still conducting operations and stuff like that over there. By this point, 2nd Battalion, 1st Marines had rotated home, and 3rd Battalion, 5th Marines took over for them. So they took over in this area here, which is like the Habania Lakes or whatever. It's like a vacation resort thing right there. So 3-5 was based out of there. And then obviously us as 3-1, we were based over here. And so their AO covered more like this area and stuff. And we were a little bit further to the east. We were still conducting normal operations and stuff over there while they're getting things kind of ready. And we did not go back anywhere really near the city until it was time to go, you know, actually back over there for the real deal. But they were picking up kind of the air campaign stuff like at night. And things like that, because there's, I guess, my last parting, you know, kind of interesting story before I end kind of this first episode, sort of setting the scene for my unit's involvement around Fallujah. So this was actually right before 3-5 came and relieved 2nd Battalion, 1st Marine. So 2nd Battalion, 1st Marines, obviously they were based east of us, and we called this area the Cloverleaf right here. So the Cloverleaf was like, that was the closest that American units would go. You know, between that, like May and November, basically. And so it was a known, if you went to the Cloverleaf that you were going to get in some shit. And so we're out here one night, my squad was, you know, we're like up here somewhere. And so we had the C-130s, AC-130s out there. So the gunships. And so I wasn't a guy, I didn't carry the radio, and I was never on the radio in my first deployment, because like I said, I was a nobody, but I happened to be by the vehicle or like in the vehicle at night, and I could hear the radio going off. And so 2-1's call sign was Warhammer. And so we can see like some green tracers kind of like skipping and flying up from over there, you know, for a far distance. Like green carries a lot at night. And so we must have had our radio set on the air freak, because we had been using C-130s to kind of help us. And there's only ever like a couple of those in country at any one time. So like I hear like Warhammer come over, and like, and so they're talking to the AC-130, and the AC-130's call sign is Slayer, which I think is just the coolest thing ever. I adopted that as like my moniker for like whenever I would have like PlayStation, you know, like usernames or like other stuff like that, strictly because of this particular incident. And so like, what, you know, they're like, you know, Slayer, this is Warhammer, you know? And the guy on the radio in Slayer, I don't know if he did it on purpose or if that's just what his voice sounded like, but he went like, "This is Slayer." Like real cryptic, like deep voice. And I was like, dude, that's the coolest thing I've ever heard. So they were kind of, and then we could see them like working stuff, you know, over with Slayer there. So I thought that was kind of a cool story, but that's where I'll leave for the first episode. So kind of setting, like I said, stuff up, you know, where my unit was, like, you know, east of Fallujah, and then occupying some traffic control points, you know, kind of getting us to the point. And we'll kind of pick up where we left off with the next episode. You know, getting us into early November, and, you know, talking a little bit about the city itself, the defenses and the defensive arrayment of the city and stuff like that. And you know, kind of work our way through there. And like I said, I'll do this in like, you know, multiple episodes, and the episodes will kind of be similar to this one in that, like, a lot of days there wasn't really much interesting that happened. And then there were days when like something really interesting will happen that'll probably take me basically a whole episode to kind of explain. But remember, guys, only the hits count, and you can never miss fast enough to catch back up.